Both the gallery and the single one. That's brilliant. That is. There she is.
Made up.
Hello.
We're she's done her own makeup.
We're recording.
Oh, good.
Are you already recording?
Tanya.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good, thanks.
Tanya, have you? You just came as you were.
What do you mean?
I feel like Eddie's been like making me dress up. Eddie's got me dressed
my
up.
T-shirt.
Like everybody's prepping.
We're meant to be wearing our t-shirts.
Eddie maybe wears something that looks like a priest, even though I'm not a priest. But...
Not essential. There will be a couple of. Michael hasn't got a t-shirt.
Oh, down the goat.
If Michael's wearing a t-shirt, it'd be madness.
How are you feeling, Seth? You gonna smash it?
Yeah, I feel fine. As I was saying just a second ago, I don't actually know who he is, so I'm fine.
Exactly.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, Anna, you're home.
Thank you, Anna. Betty.
Betty's home.
How are you doing, you two?
As if by magic.
Hi.
Yes. What's going on? Oh.
I'm so nervous.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, Pete.
Hi. How is everyone? Excited.
Really
nice
good.
To see you.
Hi, man.
Hello. Hi. I haven't dressed up for the occasion.
Oh, my God. It's so long.
Very long.
Got the right. Yeah, that's cool.
It's 59 minutes.
Where is Tomo?
Be prompt.
Do you have any supper?
Okay. Are you going to be in charge of the? Should
put it just said give us 10 minutes.
That's
and you look like you're in the 70s.
What over the hill?
Oh my God, oh my man! God.
It's so good.
What he's wearing, but he's got double tartan on for the occasion.
Oh great!
Oh, really my God.
Too dark, but he has got double tartan on.
Have you glanced the script there?
Yes.
You're feeling. You can't overact it. Don't worry about overacting.
Ham it up.
No, it's it.
Do you
need to
close
that door?
No, Cody's just said give us 10 minutes.
It could be.
Michael,
Eva. Give yourself dry mouth if you want.
Somebody did.
Tom Gobble.
Oh, gosh, everyone's there already.
Nice jumper.
Hey,
hey, it's that jumper.
What is that?
Hey, I've got to go, Tom. I need
also,
to do that for
jumper.
Wow.
Back in the screen.
Oh my God.
Is it crochet, Tom?
It's
so good.
Crochet.
Yes.
Amazing.
Yes, I might. Oh, sorry.
James and I have been discussing crochet jumpers all day. That's hilarious.
It looks something like all hay and pack I might wear.
How much was it, Tom?
It was £100.
Worth it.
But I saw a friend had made one. I thought that looks cool. I messaged her saying, oh, I want one of those. And she was like, yeah, you can have one. I was like, oh, great. And then she's like, oh, by the way, it'll be £100.
I could get Jude to make you one for nothing. She's desperate to crochet things.
Well, tell her I want another one just like this. Only.
Oh, I'll just send her that picture. So.
Keep that anyway, just in case.
That'll be great.
I feel like I should put some crochet on now and lipstick. Oh my God, need to go and change.
Hamish, have you met my father?
I have.
Oh, yeah. You have. Okay, great. lovely. Your hair is perfect for the role, I think.
Not really had in mind.
You're kind of like bicycle helmet.
It's not one of those.
Find the Concorde.
It's not attached to the.
Little bonnet.
Yeah. Very, very good. Very good.
So we're already recording, but I was just wondering if Paula, Dave, have you got any words of advice for us?
Don't look at me, Dave.
Fiona, she's not here yet.
Yay!
Not Fiona, Sophie. Sorry.
So yeah, new character. For those of you that don't know, Ant and Sandra have split up. So Sophie is taking Annabelle's role going forward. Sandra did message me yesterday and say she was very looking forward to it, and that she was planning on trying to keep the relationship going for another week just so that she might get moved to this. But unfortunately, Ant was just too intolerable to make that possible.
I can understand that.
So she. Yeah, it's there. There we go.
Hi, Sophie.
Hi.
Hi. Dad, Sophie Downs. There you go. And most, I think you know everybody else probably.
Yes.
So we're just waiting for the little lad now, are we?
We're waiting for Ant.
Yeah.
And
I think that's who he meant by the little lad, no?
I thought he was talking about his new best mate, MP. But yeah, no, just Anne, whose punctuality has never been particularly dependent.
No. Are you talking? Are you practicing?
Huh?
Are you talking?
How are you feeling, Seth? Are you feeling like a lot of responsibility on your shoulders now?
Obviously, okay. Well, I expect you're somebody. You're in the know, right? You're in the industry, so I expect some sort of new contract, maybe agency representation. Any kind of, you know, financial benefits to be accruing after this role. Thanks to you, Tom. Help me navigate my new life.
Oh, good. Apparently, MP is very excited.
Yeah.
I could be on the news. Hey!
Hi, everyone.
Hi, Anne.
Hi, Anne.
Hello.
Hi, Anne.
How's it going?
Good. Can you just bunch up a little bit, Ant, because we need to get MP in.
The screen is full now.
Yeah, it's true.
Still adding jokes. Are you pleased about that, Dave?
Yeah.
What's that?
Are you pleased that MP's going to get involved?
It was a bit stressful at 5 o'clock telling I had to write a new scene.
That's what it's like, though, isn't it, in the business?
I'm afraid it is.
Can you imagine two less likely people to have struck up a firm friendship?
Yeah. Right.
What are they doing?
They're making a show about walking around the coast.
Oh.
That's annoying. I'd like to do that.
Yeah, no, I think you'd like it very much.
And I like Michael Portillo as well. So, you know, well, good lad.
Yeah. We're just going to call him Michael because we're cool, guys. Yeah. So
about Mike.
The P word is banned. We just call him Mikey or Mikey.
Mikey P.
Definitely.
Not call him Denzel or Javier then.
Yeah, you've read the script for them. So
I googled it actually, and then I realised that was his name, and then when I came upstairs, Dad had written it in anyway.
There you go.
Okay, I'm recording. Is anyone else allowed to record down the bottom?
I can leave. No, hang on.
No, I'm supposed to give permission.
I have to request permission to record.
I just want I want two recordings just because I'm nervous.
Can you give me permission? Oh, hang on, I'm recording.
I've made you a co-host.
I'm recording.
Okay. Great. So we've got a backup.
I'm recording.
Oh, they're here. They're here, guys. Ready?
Should I turn the music off?
Don't admit until I turn
it off.
Don't say it.
Just close the laptop.
Are you
ready?
Okay, let me put my glasses on. Okay, I'm admitting.
Oh.
We should be talking, though.
Yeah. Hello, everybody.
Hi, Cody.
Hey, Cody.
Hi, Cody.
I'm just bringing the script up.
How was dinner, Coco?
Dinner was fantastic. I had
finished it.
We're waiting for pudding. we might be interrupted by pudding coming in, but we can get started so you guys can get started.
Well,
what are we putting out in a chicken?
I mean,
how is everybody?
We're good.
Yeah, good.
Happiness.
This is a bit.
Oh, here's the pudding. Actually, guys, if you give us 5 more minutes,
no problem.
We can wait Wonderful. For you.
No, we're good to go.
Oh, we are good to go.
Is that some sort of joke?
Oh my god, that's a good.
So what's the? Should we all be on mute, or are we all going to be on not mute?
No. Laughing is good.
This is my mate. This is my mate.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi, mate.
I'm expecting
Winnie back as well.
What? Oh, big lad.
Yeah, that looks lovely. Where are you?
You're in a hotel.
So like a really nice B&B. He was telling the D&D group yesterday. It looked lovely.
How long is he away for? When's he back?
Playing D&D in the B&B.
That's a good one.
Look at Cody's little cheeky face.
Blonde hair.
What do you think of the hair, Paula?
Cody's.
Yeah, Cody's.
Yeah. Spectacular, Cody.
Looks like a circle or something.
Looking like a proper Aussie.
Is he on mute?
Can we hear you, Cody?
We can't hear him. He might be able to hear us. I don't know.
He might have done it on purpose.
He probably muted us.
This is all.
So everybody, I'd like to introduce you to Michael Portello.
Good evening.
Hi, Michael.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
How are you?
Hello, Michael. Thank you very much for taking the time out of your busy schedule for this evening.
No, that's my pleasure. Oh, how did that go?
Good.
Michael, just look upon.
There we go. Right.
Michael, this could be a new career, a new start for a career for you. Just looking upon.
Yeah, I'm hoping.
I'm very much Dave there.
Hi, Dave. Very nice script.
Lovely.
You've got me to a T.
So what? I mean, are you having dinner? Are you having pudding now, or are we going straight in?
We're going with it.
Okay, fine. Dad, would you like to say?
Okay, well, this is a bit surreal tonight. But I just want to thank a couple of new members, because we've now got Nan, who is taking the place of Nan. I knew I was going to get that name wrong. I really did. I apologise. He will be playing the part of Hamish. And we have Sophie, who is taking the part of Annabelle. And we have Michael, who will be playing the part of Michael. I think that's about all. We just might as just plow into it, I suppose.
Okay,
are we ready to go?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, let's go.
Someone will be reading the stage directions, by the way, guys.
Oh, all right. Awesome.
Hang on 1 second. Stop again. Start again. Stop it.
Shoes already.
And I think go. I think go.
In his kitchen pottering about, there's a knock at the door. Michael opens it.
Well, good day to you, sir, and what a beautiful morning. Allow me to introduce myself. I'm Clayton T. Rochford the 7th, and can I inquire as to your name, sir?
Why is my name of any relevance to you, young man? And why are you knocking at my door at this unearthly time of the morning?
I'm sorry to disturb you, sir, but it's nearly 11 of the a.m., and I feel that to have any meaningful dialogue with someone, it's important to engage with heart and minds, just like W said, and that can be successfully achieved without us knowing each other's name.
Well, my name is Michael Denzel Xavier Portillo. You might have heard of me.
I'm sorry, sir, but I'm afraid that your name is unfamiliar to me. But what an impressive collection of names you have. Were you by chance named after the famous English politician Michael Foot?
You stupid boy. Where are you from, anyway?
Well, I'm born and bred in Splendora, Montgomery County, in the great state of Texas.
And what brings you to Bromsgrove, Mr. Roachford the Seventh? There's not another six of you lurking around here somewhere, are there?
No, sirree. The passing of time has diminished our numbers significantly. Currently, there's only me and Paul left, and he has trouble passing water these days.
Look, Mr. Roachford, did you say you were number seven?
I did, sir. And due to a trampoline accident, there's unlikely to be a number eight.
I sympathize, Mr. Roachford. And I do like your boots. Would you perhaps consider swapping them boots for a rather striking pink jacket?
Well, I only have one pair of boots, sir, and the soles of these are wearing very thin. I don't think it would be a fair and honest swap, especially with the dangers of trench foot lurking in these parts.
You still haven't said what you're here for.
Well, I bring to you, Michael, the good news that Jesus was born in Splendora and that I'm offering you the opportunity to meet up with me and others at the Church of the Sacred Blood of the Risen Spirit.
Are you mad?
No, sirree, Michael. The Church of the Sacred Blood of the Risen Spirit welcomes princes and paupers, and those somewhere in the middle where, if I am not wrong, I suspect you may somewhere sit.
Well, can you catch a train from, say, Austin to your little town? What did you call it?
Splendora, Michael. But no, unfortunately, due to the economic climate in Texas, you will have to travel the last 500 miles by Greyhound bus.
Well, I quite enjoy a train journey, but I'm not sure that my back would provide the Greyhound bus.
Well, the sacred blood of the risen spirit is waiting for you, Michael.
No, I'm sorry, Mr. Clayton. I'll do something else for the good Lord, but not that, and good day to you, sir.
Michael shuts the door.
Michael shuts the door and calls his agent.
Sophie? It's Michael. Michael, I've just had a brilliant idea. Listen. Michael Portillo's Greyhound bus journeys. What do you think?
Very good.
Author.
Bye-bye.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you. Amazing. Thank you. Moving on. Okay, the Harvest Kitchen, Saturday morning. Rob Harvey, his wife Susan, and son William are enjoying a mid-morning cup of coffee together.
Oh, what a wonderful innovation Saturdays are.
Maybe for you, but for me it's pretty much the same routine as any other day, looking after your needs.
Go, Nate.
Go, Nate.
What?
Cody. Cody, thank you for sorting that out. That was really funny.
Was your sound packing up in that?
Only a little bit. It'll be all right.
What's the real Friday night?
Cody.
What are you doing, Cody?
He's going to his own room, maybe.
We'll start this again, I think. Yeah, from
okay, let's do it again.
Well, from the top.
When he's ready, when he's sitting.
Yeah, get more time. Yeah, I'm back.
Well done, Coco. Coco's a booking agent.
Well done, Cody. Well done, Cody.
Oh, he's got some food.
Well done, Seth.
Yeah, absolutely brilliant.
I got it on my phone as well, so you've got him second camera.
Okay.
Right. The Harvey's Kitchen, Saturday morning. Robert Harvey, his wife Susan and son William are enjoying a mid-morning cup of coffee together.
What a wonderful innovation. Saturdays off.
Maybe for you, but for me it's pretty much the same routine as any other day. Looking after your needs.
What about the unrest associated with a Saturday night, Dad? Saturday night's all right fighting, remember? Elton John advocated that.
Oh, I shouldn't think that little turnip because fight his way out of a paper bag. Possibly give someone a nasty scratch if he's really upset, though.
Going to the pub and getting pissed and then fighting with a likely visit to A&E thrown in, all negatively associated with Saturdays.
But you can do that any night of the week now, Mum.
The poor old Neanderthal. He didn't have the luxury of having a Saturday night to look forward to.
How would he have known when to celebrate his birthdays then?
Facebook, probably, Mum.
Those grunty people all that time ago. Makes you wonder what they grunted to each other about it, doesn't it?
Probably how long it would be before someone introduced the innovation of a Saturday.
Maybe for a grunty man, Dad. Not sure it would have made much of a difference to grunty women. Cooking and keeping the cave tidy wouldn't have stopped just because it was a Saturday.
Yeah. Well, maybe that's true. But that wouldn't have stopped grunty man from thinking of ways of introducing a bit of relaxation into his hectic life schedule.
I suspect grunty women would nag grunty men about inventing fire before getting on his case about creating a day off.
You're both forgetting that Sunday is the official day of rest, and that's God's commandment. Ways to remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. He finished creation, and then only then did he take a day off.
Yeah, but he didn't say what he did on his day of rest, though, did he? What did he do on the Sabbath? He couldn't pray to himself. I suppose he could have hung out with Adam and Eve for a bit, but not every Sabbath.
He probably just sat around thinking what a clever bugger he was. Actually, I think you're both wrong. With today's flexible working arrangement and next day Amazon Prime deliveries, it's impossible for most people to observe any specific day as their official day of rest.
Yeah, but not unless you're a student, that is. They practically have every bloody day as a rest day.
Unfortunately, that's the impression most uninformed old people have of academic study, Dad.
Well, I'm sorry, William, but commencing academic study after the majority of the working population are probably already, you know, putting a couple of hours at the coalface and then wrapping up two or three more hours later and then going to the pub. It's not listed as arts graft in the book of arts graft activities.
What's so hard graft about your job then, Robert? The only way you get a good workout in your job is polishing the seat of your pants.
Right on, Mum. Old Shawnee Pants didn't like that much.
But to be fair to him, William, as his backside has got bigger over the years, there's been more polishing to do.
No, that's unfair, Susan. You know as well as I do. I put in a full shift each week.
You don't come home knackered like a miner would, all covered in sweat and black with coal dust. More's the pity, you might fancy a bit of that.
No, I don't have to scrub down in a bucket of water in front of a fire either. Jobs have changed. Occupations, you know, requiring a sweaty brow, not only recognition of our day's work these days.
And coming home with a polished backside is?
My work is brain work, Susan. I'll admit my job doesn't require physical activity, but my brain is grafting pretty much all day.
Thinking for long periods knackers me, Mum.
Waking up knackers you, William.
Any more coffee in that pod, Susan? A mid-morning motivation coffee break I find very energising.
So what are you going to be doing with all that motivated energy today then? If I know you, you'll be resting your backside in the chair in front of the television.
More polishing, Dad. Even on your day off. What a man.
Shut up, will you? I'm not sure that's a fair comment, Susan.
Most Saturday afternoons, you'll be in front of the telly, checking the progress of the Villa and all the other bloody football matches being played up and down the country, and then about six, you'll smack your lips and say, fancy a curry. I can almost set me watch by that.
Wow, you know, I'll admit sometimes I follow the footy on a Saturday, but it doesn't rule my life. If there's something more pressing that needs my urgent attention, then the footy takes the second place, you know. You know that's right, Susan.
So, what's likely to knock the footy into second place today, then?
Well, I don't know. We could visit the Forge Mill Needle Museum out Redditch Way if you fancy it. They say it's an ideal activity for the whole family.
Great. I'll check what Stella's doing. Would you like to accompany me and your dad to the Forge Mill Museum, William? Sorry, Forge Mill Needle Museum, William.
I've already been. Thanks, Mum. School trip due in the second year. Coach got a puncture in Miss... Coach got a puncture in Miss Barry and split his trousers in memory, serves me right.
That's unfortunate, especially for Mr. Barry.
Well, it was only a thought. But if you're not interested...
Who wants to visit Redditch on a Saturday? Let alone the bloody Needle Museum. I know your game, Robert. You feel vindicated now you suggested somewhere you knew full well no one would want to go. I notice you're not advocating a trip to the shops for a bit of retail therapy with me.
No. You know you enjoy shopping better if I'm not there. Peering over your shoulder, checking the price tags, you know.
Post
arrived, William. See what the postie's brought us today. There's a good lad.
William disappears and returns with an envelope.
Only a letter for you, Dad.
Mum's handwriting. Oh, I think I know what this is going to be.
Robert opens the envelope and reads aloud the contents.
Cynthia and Stanley request the pleasure of Robert, Susan, William and Annabelle at their forthcoming wedding. Service to be held at the Birmingham Botanical Gardens in Edgbaston. That's very posh. 2 p.m. 2 p.m. Saturday, 10th of November, and later at the Harold Wilson Sports and Social Club.
Not so posh.
Wow, for the wedding breakfast with the disco dancing until 11:30.
I used to go to the Harold Wilson Sports and Social Club for brownies.
It was the Sea Scouts in my case. I only joined as I thought there'd be a chance of a boat trip somewhere. But all we did was tie knots and learn the semaphore.
I didn't know you knew semaphore.
I learned how to spell help.
What made you learn how to spell help? Was it because you couldn't get on with the knots?
I wasn't too special with knots. I could tie a reef knot with my eyes closed, though. You know, left over right, right over left. It never leaves you.
I do.
Or was it right over left? No. I learned how to spell help from the front cover of the Beatles' Help record. They were semaphoring help on
the front cover. Sure, the lounge is lovely. Art Deco. I'm probably my line. No worries.
I've lost. Where are we?
Is it Michael wanting to come back and do more lines?
Michael. Get him in.
Michael's throwing my suitcase out the window from the top floor.
I think you'll find, Dad, that the Beatles...
I think you'll find, Dad, that the Beatles' arm position spelled out neither N-U-J-V or N-V-U-J, depending on which album version, English or American. You had not help at all.
You dingbat, Robert. Good job if you left your flags in an emergency then. Your emergency flag message would have been like, would have likely read, need useful jogging video.
Or need Vaseline on the jumper, Mum.
Well, how was I supposed to know that?
Maybe from your semaphore lessons. Just a wild guess.
But I wonder if they've still got the old Teddy dartboard on the wall of the old Harold Wilson's Sports and Social Club.
Just said Ridley shuffles into the kitchen, dressed in her slippers and housecoat.
Did I hear you mention something about disco dancing, Robert? I do so love to feel the throbbing thrill of a disco rhythm when it's pulsing through me.
Don't say throbbing thrill.
Don't say pulsing.
Oh, did you know you were into disco dancing, Renee?
Sorry again, as I will survive. It could have been written specifically for me, Susan.
Are you sure, Renee? I've always felt there was so much bitterness in that song.
I have every right to be bitter, Susan. I should have followed my instincts when Lionel showed an interest. I've wasted so many opportunities in my life, thanks to mainly bloody Colin. But no more. I'm going to grab life by the scruff of its neck and take all opportunities offered to me from now on.
Which Lionel was that then, Renee?
Lionel Blair. There was talk of a summer season at the Blackpool Winter Gardens.
Who's Lionel Blair?
Only Grace personified William. That was my Lionel. Anyway, that was all a long time ago now. What was I missing regarding your disco discussions, Robert?
Oh, God, Mum's getting married again. We've just had the invitation.
Is she? Good for her. Who's she marrying?
It's Stanley from the allotment. Mum's known him for ages. He was mates with her, Jim.
Well, good luck to her. Why shouldn't she be happy again? I don't know where I'm from. Just because she's not here anymore.
Well, actually, technically, still is. His ashes are on her sideboard, like.
And this Stanley bloke, he's happy about that situation, is he? Having Jim still hanging around, so to speak.
I have to say, he's been a rock, Renee. Despite the state of his gardening boots, although to be fair, since they've had all the troubles at the allotment, the bottoms of his boots have been relatively free of what's usually lurking on them.
What was the trouble up at the allotments then? I thought allotments are usually an oasis of calm and relaxation, with just a little bit of gentle exertion thrown in to keep the weeds at bay.
Don't you let Stanley you say that. They all take their gardening very seriously up there. Very knowledgeable they are too.
It's difficult to know where to start, Renee. But to cut a long story short, let's just say it involved a jacuzzi, recreational drugs, and a pair of shodden trousers.
Sounds like an episode of Line of Duty. Do you think you could swing me a wedding invite, Susan? I need to get out and meet new people.
Well, I'm not sure you'll meet anyone suitable at Mum's wedding, Renee.
You never know, Robert. A distant acquaintance might emerge and make a connection that reignites the flame of passion. Which, in my case, was extinguished soon after I married that creep.
Well, if they do, and they're not into spades, forks and wheelbarrows, then you might be in with a chance. But you might like to brush up on your snout beater knowledge as a backup.
The Harvest Kitchen, the following Sunday morning. Robert, Susan, William, Annabelle, and Beanie are just finishing breakfast.
Good night. Enough to eat, Annabelle. Would you like some more toast, Bab?
What do you think, William? I don't want to start getting hippie.
Don't worry, Annabelle. I'm afraid you've missed the bite regarding becoming a hippie. They're pretty much an extinct species these days. And I don't remember a condition of membership having anything to do with toast.
All that free love, psychedelic music, and not to mention the drugs. Do you remember, Susan? We put flowers in our hair and pushed them up the barrels of soldiers' rifles.
How many soldiers' rifles did you put up a flower at the barrel of them, Renee? I'd fuck that up. Or is that a euphemism?
Robert!
It was a movement, Robert, that changed the world. I remember meditating with Donovan. He was a very clean boy.
Do you mean he didn't get sucked into the drug scene like the majority of hippies did?
No, I mean, he washed William, which wasn't always the requisite.
The commas
why we're for being
there. There's a comma there.
Where's the comma? He washed William.
There was always a hint of Jasmine about Donovan.
Who's Donovan, Renee? Did he provide comfort during your hippie days?
He was another ship that passed me in the night, Annabelle Bab. I could have been meditating in a very special transcendental way in Rishikesh Museum.
What is that, a sentence?
I think Annabelle's referring to a hipstead.
Oh, I think Annabelle can afford another slice of toast without too much worry, William.
Tell James Corden that. The toast is a bloke no favour.
Oh, he's got to say, Corden.
Oh, just then there's a knock at the back kitchen door. It opens and Betty puts her head in.
Betty Bab, what brings you around on a Sunday morning?
I don't want to be disturbing your breakfast.
You're always welcome, Betty. Would you like some toast?
Betty!
You seem determined to shift that toast, Dad.
Oh, go on then. It does look very inviting.
Tea or coffee, Betty, to help wash it down?
Always awake at night.
It's only 10:30. That's a long time before you'll be thinking of turning in, like.
I know. The coffee also tends to keep me a bit overactive, which results in me starting things I didn't want to start in the first place. Then, when the effects of the coffee wear off, I'm left with this sort of unfinished task that I didn't want to start in the first place, still needing to be finished, love.
My granddad always said that for his breakfast, my gran usually served him up a piece of tongue pie with a slice of cold shoulder. He could be a difficult woman.
You're telling me. When Annabelle and me started going out together, we met her gran for the first time. She sent me a link to a dating site, and I don't think it was because she thought I was too good for Annabelle.
That is horrible, William. How did you respond?
Well, I told Annabelle to tell her that on the odd occasion, I might want to hear from an arsehole. I would all fart.
William!
Don't worry, I didn't pass a message on, Susan.
Isn't somebody going to introduce me to this lady?
Oh, sorry, yes, this is Betty. Betty, this is my sister Renee.
Lady.
And
Renee, shake hands.
Hello, Renee. Pleased to make your acquaintance, I'm sure. And I suspect you're a gardener, Betty. I can feel the strength in those hands, Bab. Keep them moisturised, though. I know from experience, rough hands can hold you back in life.
You don't see my hands as masculine, do you? I must admit, I don't have too much trouble getting the tops off pickle onion jars. Then there's my feet. I'm still having internal worries over the size of my feet, Robert.
Okay, you've got a gardener's feet, Betty. I would imagine that you need a firm platform when you're extracting spuds and beetroot from a dry vegetable patch.
Not too sure how reassuring that is, Renee. Are you saying I'm a bit of a chunky monkey?
Betty, Bab, please don't stress over the size of your feet any longer. No one here thinks your feet are anything other than perfectly normal. Don't forget you were under the influence when you started to have those big feet concerns.
Yes, I'm sorry, Betty. I didn't mean to offend you. I just didn't know that there was a history regarding to the size of your feet, Bab. But ignoring your feet, you've got almost classically beautiful features. Have you ever done any theatrical work?
No, I used to do a spot of cleaning and the classical club. But I chucked it in after the Meatloaf tribute night.
Meatloaf not to your musical taste then, Betty?
Not the tribute variety, Annabelle. No, that Meatloaf tribute crowd were a f-
So what brings you here today, Betty? Anything wrong?
Oh, God, I'm afraid there is, Susan, yeah. My fiscal stability is being undermined by the weakness of the pound. My gilt-edged bonds, which I've been relying on, have stopped performing to the point where my disposable income is no longer providing enough certainty for me to be able to pay the day-to-day expenses I incur.
Oh. Are you trying to say that at the end of the month there's no crackling left on your pork belly, Betty?
I don't know what that means. I don't know what that means. And I'm not sure I want to. No, no. I'm not looking to borrow, although due to the current weakness in the global economy, borrowing cash is relatively easy on secured loans. 3.74 currently. But you still got to pay it back. No, I needed a rethink on my fiscal policies that I have been living my life by this few past few years.
Well, I'm guessing you have a plan to steady your Monterey ship, so to speak, Betty. Am I correct?
You are, Robert. You are. I've decided to start my own cleaning business and I've secured enough customers to make my current financial situation much more palatable.
Well, I think that's brilliant. I hope you've retained us in your clientele list.
Well, that's why I'm here, Susan. I have put the business on a more professional basis now, treating everyone the same.
Exactly right. You couldn't run a successful business any other way.
I'm sensing a problem, Betty, with your business plan. And one that you think maybe we can help you with.
Yeah, I'd be delighted to continue providing the same services before.
Well, what's the problem then, Betty? I can see you're troubled.
If I do carry on cleaning for you all, I will have to significantly raise my prices.
Now, I know you've probably taken sound advice regarding this matter, but you don't want to be chucking the baby out with the bathwater over a few pennies,
I'm
surely.
I'm going to have to pay above minimum rates to the girls working for me.
Well, just tell us what your new rates are, Betty. I'm sure an extra couple of pounds is not going to break the bank.
Robert's right, Betty. A couple of quid, I'm sure we're not going to fall out over.
I'm afraid it's going to have to be more than just a couple of quid, though.
Oh, is it? Well, what are you going to be charging then, Betty? I'm afraid if it's too much, your business plan might not be viable.
£12 an hour. Currently, I'm here 2 times a week for 2 hours. That will mean charging you £48 a week.
Okay, fine. I see no problem with that. I don't know how much we're paying you at the moment, but 48 quid seems perfectly acceptable. What are we paying you currently anyway?
Half that. £24.
What? That's slave labour, Dad. You and Mum have been running a sweatshop.
Well, Betty's been the sweaty one.
Susan, I didn't know we were paying Betty so little.
I thought we were paying minimum wages as set out by government guidelines.
You might have been 9 or 10 years ago, Mum.
Oh, we could all be named and shamed in the Bromsgrove Bugle.
You'll be all right, Annabelle. You don't live here.
Yeah, but I could be smeared by association, though.
Robert, I'm not going to be smeared in the Bugle by association, am I? Because that could do my court case against Colin mega damage.
No one's going to be named and shamed in the Bugle or any other local newspaper come to that.
What about the national press, though? I can see the headlines now. Bromsgrove family arrested for slave labour. Mr. and Mrs. Robert Harvey, son... William, and by association, Annabelle Taylor were all charged with modern-day slavery.
Whoa. Right. Let's all calm down. I know £6 an hour is not enough, but it cannot be construed as slave labour. But he was paid, albeit, you know, inadequately.
Mentioned it in such a public way. I promise you all I'm not intended to go to the Bugle or any other newspaper. You're all my friends. I could have told Susan £6 wasn't enough and stopped cleaning here if I was so concerned about it.
You nearly ended up in the workhouse, Betty, and it would have been all my fault. I blame you, Robert.
Me? What do you mean, mate? How'd you work that out?
You always told me, look after the pennies and the pound will survive by themselves.
Well, I'll not disturb you any longer. I'll love you and leave you. Sorry to have interrupted your Sunday morning. Sunday morning. And thanks for the toast, Robert. Shall I come the same time as usual then?
tomorrow, Susan?
Certainly, Betty. I'll look forward to continuing as before, Bab.
Not exactly as before, Mum. Betty's sweat in the Harvey household must be compensated to her complete satisfaction, don't forget.
Shut up, William. If there are sacrifices to be made, you will have to carry your share of the load like the rest of us, my lad. Get off your arse and do a bit more cleaning around here.
Well, I nearly forgot, Robert. Your mum asked me to remind you that she would like you and me to meet her and Stanley next Saturday morning at her place to go over some of the wedding arrangements regarding our best man and maid of honour responsibilities.
No, I hadn't forgotten.
Well, ta-ra a bit then.
Ta-ra.
Ta-ra, Betty.
Do you think Sue's... Do you think Betty might set off for Turner an hour?
Oh!
No, she just said no.
Stella and Richie's home the same Sunday morning. Stella and Richie are just finishing breakfast. Richie puts his newspaper down.
Stella, do you believe in the hereafter?
Hereafter what?
Well, hereafter you're dead.
Oh, you mean heaven and hell and all that bullshit?
Well, I suppose that sort of answers my question, I suppose.
Why did you think it was worth asking then? You should know my opinions on that topic by now.
I was just reading this really interesting article in the Bugle, which might prompt you to reconsider your views.
Richie, you can tell me all that crackpot stories you like, but like Mum's always telling Dad, when you're dead, you're dead, and there's no coming back. I'm sorry to disappoint you, but there's no heaven or hell. I think you should start preparing yourself.
What's the point of being good then, if there's no reward or punishment at the end?
Just common decency, I suppose. Knowing that while you were around, you lived your life without causing too much unpleasantness to others.
No, not like that bloke next door with the bloody smoky bonfire every Sunday then, stinking of God knows what. I think he should reflect on that if there's a hereafter.
There you go, Richie, making a common mistake. If heaven and hell did exist, I don't think a smoky bonfire would automatically guarantee entry to hell. And I wouldn't expect God to be bothering to investigate what the bloke next door was burning on his bonfire to check if it was contravened any of heaven's rules and regulations that could determine entry or not.
What if he was burning his wife or his mother-in-law?
What, every Sunday? They'd need to be an elephant size to keep that bonfire going once a week. But let's say for argument's sake, he was burning up the remains of his wife and mother-in-law, and God did exist, and I suspect he would take an interest in that, but probably not as much as his father-in-law would, or the police come to that.
Well, you may be right, but this Bugle article definitely might make you reconsider your firm-held views regarding the subject.
Okay, Richie, I know you won't let the matter rest until you've told your story, but keep it short. I can't sit here all day discussing the improbability of an afterlife. I've got to take in the washing before Dante lights up his bloody smoky inferno again.
Right. Okay, so there's this bloke. What's his name? It's It's here somewhere. Harry Broadbrim. Yes, right, from Rainbow Hill. It's just down the road.
Richie, this is your life. Harry Broadbrim. Just keep to the main points. His name is irrelevant.
All right, okay. Okay. Well, each morning, like first thing, he would take his dog for a walk before going to work. And then we walk up Fishhouse Lane, you know, anyway. And he'd follow the path across the railway line. That spitting distance from here is literally just across the, you know, over there.
I do know. I live here too, remember?
Well, all right. A couple of weeks ago, he took his dog out as usual. But he didn't come back. Well, we're not both of them anyway. The dog returned an hour later, still connected to the lead, with Harry's cap in his mouth.
What happened? His dog didn't eat him, did he?
Well, apparently, Harry turned up 40 minutes later at Droitwich Spa railway station. He was in front of the 720 from Birmingham New Street.
Well, dead? Or clinging on somehow?
No, dead. Although, he only slid off as the train came to a stop at the station, just kind of...
And the train driver didn't seem getting on, so to speak.
Well, either that or he didn't want to be late to Droitwich Spa. There's penalties for arriving late, you know.
Poor man. But what's all this got to do with the afterlife?
Well, apparently, he was in a bit of a mess after we found him. Those trains to and from New Street don't half shift. So his wife decided to have him buried in the dog walking clothes that he was wearing when the train hit him.
And?
Well, after about a week after his funeral, she started to notice some strange goings on around the house.
What do you mean, strange goings on?
Well, you know, she'd kind of get up in the morning and she'd find some, like, drawers and cupboards open, which she was sure she'd closed the night before. And little things just kind of moved around and that, you know.
Burglars, perhaps?
Well, if it was, nothing appeared to be missing. It was just... Then, just as soon as it started, it all stopped.
She probably had nothing of value in the, and that the thief could be bothered carting away.
The only thing they discovered missing was Harry's old dog walking cap. Can you believe it? Which was hanging on the peg by the front door.
And I think this Harry came back from the other side to fetch his cap?
I don't know. Maybe, is what I'm saying. He was wearing his dog walking clothes at the time of his demise. Seems likely he might have felt a bit underdressed without his cap.
Suddenly, their conversation is interrupted by a knock on the front door. Richie goes to see who's there.
Oh, hello.
Howdy, and a very good morning to you, sir. And what a beautiful day we have today.
I've a feeling from your cowboy boots, accent, and slogan on your T-shirt, make Jesus great again in suspenders, that you're probably not from Bromsgrove. Is that right?
Well, my T-shirt don't say make Jesus great again in suspenders.
Oh, well, I can't see all of it because your jacket's covering up.
Sir, it says, make Jesus great again in Splendora. And as Jesus never wore breeches, as far as I know, it would seem unlikely he would be requiring to wear suspenders or a belt.
I'm sorry, make Jesus a great in suspenders, although I accept it's a little unconventional. It still makes more sense than make Jesus great in splendiferous. What does it say? Say again.
Splendora, not suspenders, and not splendiferous.
No. I think you should reconsider your slogan, mate. It's most likely it will only lead to confusion with people around here in Bromsgrove.
Look, please forget my T-shirt, sir. However, you are all right. I am not from these parts. But let me introduce myself. I am Clayton T. Roach for the 7th. And can I inquire as to your name, sir, if it is not an imposition?
I'm Richard Foster.
What a great English name. And very popular in the States, I might add. Were you named after the great English entrepreneur, Sir Richard Branson, by chance? Or perhaps the very noble Richard the Lionheart?
No, but it is strange that you asked me that, Clayton, because I've always felt a bit of a, you know, kindred spirit with Branson. Do you know what I mean? I sold all my sister's records when I was 15. And that was before I was a few years younger than Branson when he started flogging his.
And you divided the profits equally with her? Or did you keep a percentage in true entrepreneurial fashion?
I never told her, Clayton. She never played, so... Just
Well, there's no connection with the noble Richard the Lionheart then.
Suddenly, Stella appears at the door to see what's keeping Richie.
Who are you talking to, Richie? Hmm. Oh, hello. I'm afraid noble is not a word I would use to describe my Richie.
Oh, good day to you, ma'am. My name's Clayton T. Roach for the 7th.
Oh, pleased to meet you, I'm sure. There seems to be a bit of the prairie and just a touch of the Wild West about you, Mr. Watchford.
Well, that's because I'm born and bred in Splendora, Montgomery County in the great state of Texas, where they build a straight and the grow as tall, ma'am.
I can certainly see that, Mr. Watchford. And you're a typical example of those Texas people, are you?
Well, call me Clayton, ma'am. And can I inquire as to your name?
Oh, I'm Stella. I'm married to Richie, here for me sins. At this point, Clayton, I think I should warn you that getting involved in deep conversation with my husband is likely to lead to confusion and despair. What can we do for you?
Well, that's a very generous question, Stella. And you don't hear warm words often spoken too often in these troubled times of dangerous consequences. I don't, if I'm being totally honest with you, here, what good can we do for you, Clayton, much in my travels?
You're not anything to do with pyramid selling, are you, Clayton? Because you don't want to get involved with that caper.
What I'm offering you here today has nothing to do with selling Egyptian artifacts. Tell me, Stella, what would you say if I could offer you a way out of the uncertainties of life, provide you with some reassurance as to the correct path you and Richard here should consider taking?
The correct path to where, though, Clayton?
Redemption, Stella. Redemption.
I'm not sure I've ever considered the finer advantages of redemption before.
I'm going to be totally honest with you, Clayton. I'm not sure what redemption is when applied to me and Stella. Or anyone else, for that matter.
I know it's not a concept that is easily grasped, but if you will permit me to explain more fully, I'm sure you will then be excited, packing suitcases in readiness for meeting up with me and the rest of my congregation at the Church of the Sacred Blood of the Risen Spirit to begin learning once again how to live a new, much fuller life within the sacred blood.
Right, now hang on a moment, Clayton, because I can't speak for Stella, like, but if I wanted to spend a new life, you know, wading around through blood, be it sacred or not, I think I'd probably go to work with me Uncle Billy in his abattoir.
Are you here flogging religion then, Clayton? Because we're not very religious people. We, or should I say I, don't believe in the hereafter, but I don't want to be rude, so I'll accept any literature you may have and wished you a good day.
Yeah.
Look, I am not selling anything, Stella. I stand before you naked, a financial incentive. What is so difficult for you Bromsgrove folk to grasp regarding that concept? Do I look like a snake oil charlatan?
You seem to be getting a bit upset, Clayton, and I hope it's nothing I've said or that Stella's said or anything.
I did warn you earlier, Clayton, regarding conversations with Richard.
I have to admit, I am discovering that spreading my church's good news to Bromsgrove folk is not as easy as the spiritual elders of the Church of the Sacred Blood of the Risen Spirit led me to believe it
would
be.
We're a Christian country, Clayton, yeah, but we have our compassion for our fellow man, don't we?
Richie's right. It's just that not many of us believe in God anymore.
On my travels, the length and the breadth of the Midlands, I meet mostly nice people, although I did have one guy throw the contents of his mother's commode at me. That was not very pleasant.
That sort of behaviour needs reporting, Clayton. Even if you were being a pain in the backside, there's no excuse for chucking excrement about the place.
I was told I'd be greeted like a disciple carrying the good news message regarding the sacred blood to the doubters and those that are in spiritual need.
Well, can I just remind you of the fate of John the Baptist, Clayton? He was a disciple of Jesus and he got his head cut off by a stripper, if I recall correctly.
Well, I must admit to you both, I am becoming despondent. The church elders told me I would be invited into people's homes, integrated into their family circles. No one's invited me into their communion. The soles of my boots are wearing thin, and I've been warned of the dangers of trench foot, which I understand is pretty common in these necks of the woods. I believed the elders when they told me that God would provide, but I've seen very little evidence so far.
And how are you supporting yourself, Clayton? Didn't these elders provide cash for your crusade and replacement soles for your boots while you're over there?
Well, that's another problem. No one here accepts the Church of the Sacred Blood of the Risen Spirit's credit card. And the elders told me it'd be universally accepted in both heaven and on earth.
Well, I don't know about Clayton. I don't know about heaven, Clayton. I don't. But even the corp around here takes debit cards.
What are you living on then? Did you bring cash with you?
Well, I have £15 worth of traveler's checks left. And after that, I suppose I'll have no other choices but to wait for God in his infinite wisdom to provide for me.
You could be dead by then. If God is busy with, you know, other more pressing problems.
Get back to your church elders, Clayton. Tell them you need more cash. Just while you're waiting for God's, you know, cash to come through, like.
Well, they've stopped accepting my collect calls, Richie. And I slept on a bench in Sanders Park last night.
No.
You'd better come in, Clayton. I can't in all consciousness send you off into the depths of Bromsgrove in this state.
Yeah, come in, mates. Come on, sit yourself down. Would you like a cup of tea or something, or coffee?
How about some nice beans on toast?
Do you have grit, Stella?
Clayton, I got beans on toast.
That'll do just fine, Stella. Thank you.
How's your faith, Clayton? You know, after the little setback in bringing the rising blood and all the sacred spirit and all that to the people of Bronzegrove.
Sacred blood of the risen spirit, Richie. I feel ashamed, Richie and Stella. I was beginning to lose my faith, not only in myself, but more importantly in my church elders, and felt that they and God had forsaken me in this fallen land where the dangers of trench foot are so prevalent.
And you don't think they have? Sending you over here with an iffy credit card, not accepting your revenge charge call, your reverse charge call.
Revenge charge call, please.
You wake up and find your rucksack, your pockets violated, scouts.
But don't you see, my dear Stella and Richie? God and the elders have somehow seen my distress, understood my predicament, and fully answered my prayers. I have seen provided after meeting you two, friendship, warmth, and some beans on toast. And if I'm any sort of judge of character, a bed for the night.
Have you?
Have you?
Do, 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 do.
Cynthia's home. It's Saturday morning the following week. Cynthia and Stanley are finishing breakfast.
You had enough to eat, Stan. There's more bacon if you'd like.
Timbab, I've eaten like a king this morning. The bacon was cooked crisp to perfection. The egg yolks were correct consistency for my taste. Not too firm and soft enough to moisten the fried bread. I couldn't eat anymore. But I'll have another cup of tea, Pet.
Oh, coming up, lad.
Oh, and I have to say, if it's not too delicate, but the pre-breakfast appetizer before we got up, like, me and my toes curl in a very unexpected way.
Cynthia returned with Stanley's tea.
Oh, it's been a long time since that sort of carry-on had been carrying on in that bed, Stan.
Well, for a woman of your age, Cynthia, I have to say that I found you to be very energetic. Very subtle.
That'll be on the account of my garlic and cod liver oil tablet.
Well, maybe I'm going to have to start taking cod liver oil tablets as well, and garlic tablets. I'm going to have to, you know, keep up, like, with the, they don't really do much for your breath now, do they?
Well, my Jim used to say that when he got a whiff of my garlic and cod liver oil, he knew he was about to hit the spotlight.
I think he knows what... I think I know what he means. I smelt the garlic and the cod liver oil just before you shouted, "Let's go, Geronimo!" And I think it was about that time what was just being hit this morning.
Well, you'll have no complaints from me on your performance, cod liver oil or not. But Betty and Robert will be here soon. Maybe you'd better take Jim's slippers off before they get here. We don't want any unnecessary family gossip doing the rounds before the wedding.
Stanley removes Jim's slippers and puts on his shoes. Cynthia puts Jim's slippers away.
Stanley, they're not my elasticised surgical ankle socks you're wearing, are they?
Oh, Cynthia, they're my own. I've got a bit of water retention.
Oh, you should get that looked at. We don't want to be worrying about water retention on the honeymoon.
Oh, no. About me water retention, Simbab. I've already shown the doctor.
What did he do?
He gave me a tap on the knee. Did you get it, Sin? Did you get it? He gave me a tap on the knee. For me water retention. A tap, you
know. You're a funny bugger, Stanley Oswald.
Hey, looks like Robert and Betty's arrived.
And he goes to let them in.
Come in, people. Sit yourselves down. Stanley, put the kettle on. There's a pal.
Hey, Simbab. Blimey, you've got Spudley well trained, haven't you?
Oh, it's still a work in progress, Betty, especially regarding his sock drawer.
Hello, Ma. You're looking well today, if a little flushed.
Am I, Robert? Oh, I can't think why.
You haven't been exerting yourself this morning, have you? Your cheeks seem redder than normal.
Robert is right. You do seem to have a bit of a glow about you this morning.
Stanley will turn to a tin biscuit.
We were saying the mum looks a bit flushed this morning, Stan.
Does she? I noticed. You've been okay, Sibab?
All right, it's 9 pence, Stan. Don't any of you start worrying over me.
Come to mention it. It's cuddly.
Oh, fuck's
sake. You look a bit flushed this morning, too.
Well, that might be because I've got my head too close to the steam coming at the kettle like.
Forget about Stan and my pink cheeks. I've got some exciting news regarding the wedding for the pair of years.
You haven't changed the venue and decided to get married on a beach at the Virgin Islands, have you, ma'am?
Oh, I think that boat sailed for us both some time ago, Robert. No, we're still getting married in the Botanical Gardens as planned, but when Stan and me went there to have a look around, they entered us into a free competition, provided we paid a 20% deposit to confirm the booking up front.
How exciting. What do you win if you win?
Well, they couldn't...
But they said there'd be several prizes, but the top prize was very special.
And last week I got a phone call from them telling me that we've only won the top prize.
Congratulations. What have you won then?
A good show. Well done.
Come on, Stan. You are probably more excited than me, if truth be told. Tell them what we've won.
Are you sure, Sinbad? I don't want to steal your thunder.
Just tell us what you've won. Bloody suspense is rising my blood pressure now.
The Botanical Gardens are allocating us the most experienced wedding planner. He or she will organise everything for us. They will take the stress out of the event, and all we need to do is turn up on the day and enjoy it.
Yeah, and pay for it.
Well, yes, you know, we have to pay for it, but the wedding planner will be able to provide special offers and reductions because, you know, they cater for so many weddings. The wedding planner is coming in this morning to meet us all and discuss arrangements. They'll be here in half an hour.
It's really great. I'm so happy for you, both of you. It promises to be a wonderful occasion.
Robert suddenly peers out the window.
Oh, there's a little dapper lad coming up your path, Mum. I have a feeling this is your wedding planner arriving a bit early.
Well, at least he's keen. That for him.
Robert goes to answer the door. He opens the door before the person has time to knock.
Well, hello. I'm Hamish for the Highlands. You must be Stanley.
Actually, no. I'm...
Oh, do my eyes deceive me? Oh, my God. It's the Ice Commander, if I'm not mistaken, from the Three Bs.
The Three Bs?
Barry's, the Bend Over Bar, a couple of weeks ago. I'm the part-time bar manager for my sins.
Well, pleased to meet you, I'm sure. Come in and meet everyone.
Hello, people. I'm here in the island. How are we all today?
Oh, what a group safe to meet the others. Hold on, sorry. Hamish first greets Bessie.
And you must be the lass of the moment. Lovely to meet your acquaintances, Cynthia, my love.
Hamish and Bessie shake hands.
What a strong handshake you have there, Hen. The circles I move in. Well, well, we all much prefer a firm handshake, if you get my drift. Limp is, well, just limp, isn't it? And no use to a man nor beast.
I think you may have mistaken me. I'm not Cynthia.
Hamish ignores Betty and turns his attention to Stan and Cynthia.
And you two are? Now, don't tell me. I have a nose for this. OMG squared. Is it, or am I totally blowing up the wrong bagpipe? But it's Johnny Ace, is it not?
Well,
Cynthia look confused, Robert, Stanley look awkward.
Who would have thought Johnny Ace and the Ice Commander? Well, I'm totally made up, gentlemen. I must say, the boys in the Three Bs are still taking, are still talking about the Knight, Johnny Ace, the Ice Commander, Wolverine, and what was the fourth one's cheeky little name? Oh, by the way, we have his shoe in Lost Property.
Oh, you know, Tommy the Fish.
What a little scamp he was. His dance moves were something not seen in the Three Bs before.
Where did you find his shoe then? Because we looked everywhere.
Well, I have to say, it wasn't strictly lost, more appropriated, actually. Dominic took quite a shine to young Tommy the Fish.
Well, it certainly wouldn't have been shine from his shoe that attracted Dominic. I'm pretty certain of that. Young Tommy the Fish being a fully paid up member of the Scruffy Student Fraternity.
He found his shoe tucked under a table and took it home as a keepsake. He's a good lad and realised his errors and the errors of his ways and brought it back to the Three Bs.
Hamish, lad, you're making little sense. Is he making any sense to you, Betty?
I am totally flummoxed, Cynthia.
Can we try and clarify some of the things you've just been saying regarding Stanley, Robert and Tommy the Fish, whoever he is? Then perhaps we can set you straight on who you're here to plan a wedding for, young Hamish.
Because you can, Mrs.
Right. Right. Just did a Scottish accent.
Right!
Right, I'm Mrs. Harvey. This here is Stanley Oswald, my intended. The Ice Commander over here, I have always known since his birth, like, as Robert Harvey, my son.
And I am Betty.
Go on, Betty.
Not related to anyone here, not Johnny Ace, nor the Ice Commander, come to that.
And what's this Three Bs you keep banging on about? And who's Dominic?
It was just a spot of fun that was to devise for Stan's stag night, ma'am.
Who is Tommy the Fish?
That'll be William, Betty Babb.
Oh, so by process of elimination, Richie must be Wolverine?
Yes, ma'am. Richie's Wolverine.
Why did he call himself after a bear?
We think it was the bloke with the pointy knuckles that was calling himself after that, not the bear.
The question's still begging to be asked. Although I suspect I'll not be able to get an answer to, is why you felt it necessary to change all your names anyway?
Well, it was Richie's idea, but let's not get into that and whys and wherefores now, Betty. Come on.
I'm sorry, ladies. I didn't know you were so much in the dark. The Three Bs, as I call the place, is Barry's Bendover Bar on Paradise Street.
Ah, well, say no more. That explains everything. If bloody Barry's Bend over bars involved.
Still doesn't explain who Dominic is and what he had to do with William, or should I say Timmy the Fish and Shoe.
It's Tommy the Fish, Betty.
After Dominic found young Tommy the Fish's shoe, he decided to keep it as a memento of a great evening with those two and other two gentlemen. But he saw his error of his ways, and to be totally honest with you, his small flat couldn't cope with the smell being chucked up by the shoe, so he brought it back.
Yeah, William's feet do chuck up. And another curse it inflicts my student.
Aye, his shoe's already beginning to peel the paint off the Three B's lost property office.
So now we've established that I'm Stanley, or you can call me Stan, Spud, or even Spuddly if you like, it's me who's getting married to Cynthia.
OMG cubed. I didn't know. Just jump to conclusions. I'm so sorry. My Brendan says I'm like a skunk in a pulpit. All distractions by jumping in too soon.
Well, that's all the confusion sorted. Can we start to plan this wedding, Hamish?
Now, I look with my eyes and not with my intuition. I can see the love light in both your eyes, Cynthia and Stanley. And the fresh flush of love is still in both your pink cheeks. What a bonny couple you two both make. In Scotland, we hear a saying called Lang me your lum reek. I haven't arranged for weddings in such senior couple before, although I have done a few wakes. So, wakes or weddings, people are always there to hear a good time, are they not?
Oh, that. I'm not sure about a wake, Hamish.
It all depends on your perspective, Robert.
can I ask you, Hamish, what does lang me your run break mean exactly?
Originally, Betty, it meant long may your chimney smoke.
That's not a smutty Scottish saying, is it, Hamish? Because neither me nor Stanley smoke, and we don't have a chimney.
Nay, hen. The global warming has meant its meaning has changed a bit, got a bit more cryptic. It just means I wish you a long and happy lives.
Yeah, we do need to start planning now, Hamish. At this rate, we'll all be late for the wedding if we don't start speeding things up, like.
I couldn't agree more, Robert. Let's stop pulling the thistles through the heather and start slicing the haggis, shall we?
Well, if that means crack on, then lead on, Macduff.
Macduff, the saviour of Scotland. I'll take that, laddie. Now, let's get started, Cynthia. You're the bride.
I am.
Stanley, you're the bridegroom.
That's right.
And you, laddie, you are officer.
I'm Miss Chancellor Robert.
And you, laddie, you are, apart from being the ice commander.
Stanley's best man and Cynthia's my ma.
I'm Miss Chancellor Betty.
And you, my bonnie lassie, with the pleasantly, surprisingly firm grip.
Maid of honour.
And who will be giving the bride away?
Good question, Hamish. Who is giving you away, mum?
Oh, I don't know. I suppose I thought it'd probably be you, Robert. But Stan's gone and got in first, like.
Well, do you want me to find another best man then, Sin?
Well, what's like a second best man, Stan? No, I wouldn't hear of it.
What about Uncle Graham? I mean, I know you haven't seen much of him lately. But if you were thinking of inviting him to the wedding, you know, he might do it.
Have you lost your marbles, Robert? I wouldn't sully my wedding by asking that man.
I know there was a bit of bad blood between you and him, but I thought that was years ago.
You're right, Robert. It was a long time ago now, but I wouldn't pull the plug, even if he was drowning in a bath of his own piss.
Well, I think we can rule Graham out then.
I'm not even sure he's been let out anyway.
Well, how about young William? I mean, he's close family. And although he can be a bit weird, you know, with a hair like, you know, he's got a good heart. And if you can, you know, get him to put his phone down, I'm sure he wouldn't let anyone down.
Bastard. Well, are you sure, Stan?
Well, you tell me. Who else can take my arm walking me up the aisle, Robert?
Well, okay. If you're sure, ma. Tommy the fish it is. I'll wake him up and I'll get back and give him the good news.
I'm in the fish.
Stanley's home. It's Saturday mid-morning and wedding day. Robert is with Stanley helping him get ready.
Bloody hell, Stan. What are you doing with that tie, lad?
Can't remember when I last wore a tie, if I'm being honest, Robert. I'm as awkward as a pig with a crutch this morning.
Come here, lad. Come here, let me have a go. I did knots in the Sea Scouts, so I don't know if you know that.
I don't want to end up with a clove hitched around my neck.
Don't worry, Stan. I only mastered the reef knot.
If I'm being honest, Robert, I don't really fancy getting married in a reef knot either.
Oh, come here. I'll give you a nice Windsor knot. No one's going to complain about a Windsor knot round your neck, lad.
I'm a bundle, Robert. I didn't get much sleep last night.
Well, yeah, I can see that you are, Stan. You're shaking like a leaf. What are we doing now? Where's that gone? You're shaking like a leaf. Let's get some of this brandy down us to steady your nerves, like.
Hey, we should send the bottom holes over.
Yeah, they're very unusual, but no, Stan. I can see the Hamish influence. They've got a very, like, north of the border look about them.
Aye. Purple thistle, white heather, and tartan ribbon. But I quite like them.
Well, you know, I'm not sure they go with you for three Nelson Mandela slippers, I suppose, to be fair.
Oh, bloody hell. See the state I'm in. I'd be walking down the aisle in those three Nelson Mandela slippers if you hadn't noticed, Robert.
Well, I'm sure they would have been spotted before you got that far, Stan. You must have had them slippers on longer than Nelson Mandela was actually banged up.
Well, I keep those slippers as a constant reminder of the dangers of drinking too much.
Well, how do you mean?
Well, look at this.
Stanley takes off his jacket and rolls his sleeves of his shirt up.
Oh, Fray Willie Nelson. Blimey. That's a fine tattoo, that is, Stan.
I got it when I was serving in the Navy. Pista was. It was Manila. And I'm sure I asked the bloke in the tattoo shop for a free Nelson Mandela tattoo. I was very supportive of Nelson Mandela during the time of his incarceration. And when it came to senses of the body, I had free Willie Nelson on my arm. No slippers. I think the bugger realised he made a mistake too late and sent me away with the wrong tattoo and no slippers, presumably as some sort of compensation.
Well, didn't you go back and, you know, seek a more substantial compensation package than the slippers?
Late. By the time I came to, like, the bloody ship had sailed.
Well, it's a good job we didn't pass any tattoo parlours on your statue then, Stan. Because I don't think you were wearing those slippers that night. Well, right. Anyway, are you ready to go? Are you sure you've done everything I was supposed to remind you to do, like?
I don't know. What were you supposed to remind me about? As far as I'm concerned, you spotting the Nelson Mandela slippers already saved me from total embarrassment.
What about the ring, Stan? Ain't I supposed to keep him safe, like, in my waistcoat pocket until the vicar calls him for the ring to be presented?
We had a bit of a problem with Sin's ring, Robert. We couldn't get Jim's old wedding ring off her finger on account of the swollen knuckle.
So what's the plan, then?
He didn't know what to do, and Sin was reluctant to remove it anyway, especially as it would have meant cutting it off.
Well, yeah, I see a problem. So what have you decided to do, then? Dispense the wedding rings?
Yes, but we still wanted to exchange something significant during the ceremony, so...
So, what did you come up with then?
We're going to exchange names.
What? You're going to call yourself Cynthia and Mum? You'll be called Span?
No. That would be very confusing for us and everyone else come to that.
Well, yeah, you're not wrong there, Stan.
My new name was easy. And I got the idea from Betty when she suggested we have a double barrel last name. My full name is Stanley Harold Oswald. But from today, I will change my middle name to Stanley Harvey Oswald in memory of my late mate, Jim.
Oh, Stan, that's really nice. What a wonderful solution to a tricky problem. And you and Mum aren't likely to be holidaying in America, are you?
Don't expect so. Why do you ask?
Well, no reason, Stan. What's Mum changing her name to?
Well, Sim will change her middle name from Norma to Sweet Aroma. It's one of my favourite sweet potatoes. And it's also a nod to my nickname, Spud.
Well, another perfect choice. Pretty close to Norma, too.
We hope that you'd like the idea, Robert.
Give us your glass, Stan. And I'll give you a toast. To Cynthia, Sweet Amora, and Stanley Harvey Oswald. May you both be very happy. Cheers.
Well, Robert, look, the car's arrived. It's not too early, is he? I mean, we don't want to be getting mixed up with an earlier wedding. Should one be taking place, like? Well, kind of, with a very unfortunate mix-up, you know, caused by getting to the church too early. He met his ex-wife coming out and ended up in more of her wedding photos than his own. Very unfortunate.
No. The timing's fine, Stan. Calm down. Have you remembered to sort your cat out? Because I keep getting away from fish.
Nathan Jones has pissed off again, Robert, and I don't know where he's gone. No, that would be me garlic and cod liver oil tablets, you can smell.
Call back.
Cynthia's home. It's Saturday morning and wedding day. Cynthia, Betty, Susan, Stella, Annabelle, Rini, Richie, and William are all gathered helping Cynthia with her wedding preparations.
I'm so excited to be invited to your wedding, Dan. I've always wanted to go to an old person's wedding, having unfortunately missed me mum's. And William is very proud to have been asked to give you away.
Oh, poor Annabelle. Fancy missing your own mother's weddings. What happened, Bab?
Well, I wasn't born, Renee.
You almost attended our mum's wedding, Renee. She went into labour walking up the aisle when she was carrying you.
Oh, I wasn't an illegitimate Susan, was I?
Oh. It doesn't make any sense. No, I think you're on until...
That's
until
not through the proofread.
Stella, I think you hung on until after the I pronounce you man and wife bit, but with mum keeping her knees tied together.
That explains why she looks not need in her wedding photos then.
I'm just pleased you could attend, Annabelle, and that William agreed to walk me up the aisle.
That's a very strange expression though, don't you think?
What? Walk me up the aisle?
No, giving you away. Like, it seems to smack of an old colonial custom that should have been dispatched to the waste bin years ago. Now we're living in these more enlightened times.
Same as to honour and obey has been mostly dumped these days. Can you imagine? I actually promised to honour and obey that shit, Colin. I'd rather donate my tongue to a good cause than have to do that again.
That'd be being rude, Renee. What good cause would you want your tongue? What good cause would want your tongue?
Renee does have perfect diction, Susan, and not a trace of a Bromsgrove accent.
You're telling me.
You're not very perceptive, and right as William to give Gran or anyone else away. Maybe Gran doesn't want to be given away.
I don't think Spud will be expecting William to be presenting him with an invoice at the end of the day for marrying Gran, though.
I've never thought about it before, but Annabelle's quite right. The words suggest that William's treating Gran as if she was his property.
Mm. Oh, it's just part of the ceremony, Mum. I'm sure your dad gave you away when you got married. It's just traditional.
Your father was so tight, William. My dad had to pay for his bus fare to the church.
I'll check with Hamish later. We don't want to be setting a precedent today. But on the other hand, I don't want to be seen as part of William's shackles.
I don't think you find it is a largely ceremonial expression, Gran. Dating back to when dowries were expected to be paid to the bridegroom and letting him know that from now on, the father of bride ain't responsible for any expenses she might run up later.
Oh, I think I'll still check with Hamish. Don't want to be getting into anything that's likely to be put in the woman's lib or the Me Too movement back years.
Like William says, look, it's tradition, Gran. Like traditions, you know, they keep us balanced. So without traditions, life would be chaotic. Men do the gathering and the providing, women do the worrying and the moaning. It's just the way of the world.
Richie, it seems your brain cell count has started diminishing quicker than even I was expecting.
No, Richie's right, Stella. Work, leisure, and religion, all influenced by tradition. Without traditions, our lives would be as shaky as a...
Fiddler on the roof.
On the roof!
Thank you.
What a man. Now there was someone who could grow a beard. Pity he was so old when our paths crossed. I'll always remember him with affection, though.
Who was Topple, Renee? Really, was he someone you knew, like Tony Blair?
Lionel Blair, Annabelle. Tony. But to answer your question, there was no comparison between Topple and my Lionel. Topple was a very different man from Lionel.
Yes, you wouldn't find Topple down the old bend over bar, Annabelle. However, Lionel, I'm not so sure.
Can we give you our wedding present now, Gran? William and me are very excited about it. Aren't we, William?
We are. It's the most original and selfless gift anyone could give anyone, Gran.
Oh, William, you are a good boy. Mum's probably got enough plates, glasses and linen anyway.
Oh, you've got me all excited now, Annabelle. I'm sure Stan will understand if you give it to me now, Bab. Can always wrap it up and let him open it again later.
Annabelle, give Cynthia an envelope.
Well, thank you, Annabelle and William. Your thought processes are an inspiration to us all. Oh, what's this then? photo of a goat?
No, it's not just any goat, Gran. It's yours and Stanley's goat.
Our goat? Where are we going to keep a goat? Stan and me had a long chat about Nathan Jones, wondering if he should come and live with us. Luckily, I believe he's disappeared again, and I think Stan has put a nail in the cat flap. I don't think we've got room for a goat, Annabelle.
Gran's right. You haven't thought this through, William. She's not got room for a goat. She might even be contravening some bylaw regarding goats kept in back gardens, especially now she's astroturf laid. She's laid the bloody astroturf.
What made you think your gran needs a goat, William?
No, don't worry, Gran. You won't be keeping the goat.
No. Everybody fucking chill. We've sent it to China.
Who's got mine and Stan's goat who's in China? We don't know anyone who lives in China.
That's a poor peasant family, Gran, who've no material wealth and no access to
aliens.
What am I going to do with my goat? I don't think a goat can be classed as medicinal.
Well, the children of the village get to drink warm, nutritious goat milk every day.
And the village family elders get to sleep with the goat at night for warmth.
Which is a bit like an electric blanket. Or a hot water bottle.
Or a blanket.
I'm not sure I would be happy with some elder sleeping with my goat, even if it was only for warmth.
How much are you paying for this goat to go and live in China then, William?
Get this. It's £5 a month. For 2 years, they'll send you a photo for the goat each month with a note, Gran, so you see how he's getting on.
What happens after 2 years? Do they send it back, like? Because I still don't think I'd be wanting the responsibility any more in 2 years than I do now.
No. And after 2 years, it probably have gotten used to sleeping
with you too. No.
And you wouldn't want it in bed with you and Stanley every night.
Renée's right. Not every night.
No. I don't think Stan will be too happy having to sleep with an old goat every night. And nobody had better make a smart aleck move about that remark either.
Don't worry, Gran. After 2 years, I think they go.
What? Eat mine and Stan's goat? And all we've had to show for it will be 24 photos of a goat looking miserable.
No, I don't think it would understand it was going to be eaten, Gran.
I think the penny might have dropped when they cut its throat and stuffed a spit up its backside.
Savage.
We do have a buyback clause if you don't want it, if you don't want them to eat it, Gran.
No, I wouldn't want mine and Sans go eaten, William. How much to buy it back then?
Well, I think it's quite expensive due to transportation costs.
It's about £1,000, Gran.
Are you sure you sent it to Chinese peasant village and not the mafia? Sounds like a case of abduction, hostage taking and extortion to me.
Where's this poor animal now, William?
Oh, I'd say probably on a ship just leaving the port of Ramsgate, Gran.
Ramsgate? Quite appropriate, I suppose. My poor Billy the Kid, napped goat.
The path to disappointment is paved with good intentions, William and Annabelle.
I'm sorry, Gran. I'll ask them to send it back, and I'll not ask for me money back.
Oh, thanks, William. It was a nice thought. But on reflections, I could use a new toaster.
Well, I hope it's got its sea legs, this goat. Travelling all the way to China on a boat and then turning round and sailing back again.
You couldn't risk it, Stella. I've heard the only thing on four legs in China that they won't eat is a table.
I think that's not okay.
I think the only thing they won't eat with four legs in China is a table and a chair.
Stuck it through the proofread.
Here's Cynthia Bab, have my wedding present. It's a little wacky, but I'm hoping it's more fun than William Annabelle's goat was. I just want to add my thanks for the wedding invitation. I know we haven't seen much of each other over the years.
Thanks, Renee. You're right, it's been a long time. When did we last see each other? What's this present anyway?
It's a remote control flying fish. You and Stan can have lots of fun with it. I think we last met at that strange afternoon we spent together at Cousin Tracy's confirmation.
Let's not revisit that particular afternoon, Renee. Today's not the day.
Pity your husband. What was his name? Colin, wasn't it? Couldn't have joined you today, but I understand you've had a bit of trouble at home.
Trouble? He's dead to me, Sim. I'm getting a divorce. He smacked me around for the last time.
How was that?
What?
Oh, my God. He was that thin, tiny little chap, wasn't he? He didn't look as if he had the strength to get excited, let alone violent.
He's got a very wiry frame, Sin, which I found very difficult to pin down when a scuffle breaks out.
Fucking
hell. We heard it's a bowl of cockaleaky soup that caused the fiction.
Camel's back, Betty. The intimidation and aggravation have been going for years. I can't bear to think about him, who shall remain nameless.
Oh, the bloke with no name. The good, the bad, the ugly.
Oh my God, it's times like these. I'm pleased you've already lived half your life, Richie. Which means I'm halfway through my sentence. Unfortunately, there's no time off for good behaviour in this prison.
That's sort of a nice thing to say, is it?
Birmingham, babe. Back to Birmingham, babe.
Richie, that film sums up my marriage perfectly. Only the good bit happened mostly before I met the bastard.
So Eastwood was in that film. Have you met him before, Renee? Like at the Blackpool Winter Gardens?
No, Annabelle. Clint Eastwood and my paths have so far, unfortunately, not crossed.
Well, you better be getting your skates on, Renee. I believe Clint must be in his 90s now. Oh, look. Was you expecting Hamish this morning, Sin?
No, Betty, we're meeting him at the Botanical Gardens.
No, that's him coming up your path, looking very dapper in a kilt.
Cynthia goes to the window.
Oh, you're right, Betty, it is him. Looks very determined, doesn't he? I hope there's not a problem. Can you go and let him in, William Bab?
William, let's go to let him in.
Hello, I'm Hamish Feeder. Oh my God, do my eyes I'm Hamish from the Bendover Bar, from behind the bar. Nice to meet you again, lad. You don't recognise me, do you?
I'm afraid lots of what happened that night is lost to me, Hamish. But hello and come in. We're expecting you this morning.
What's going on
with that? Well, we were steaming that night, laddie. However, I
did... Just tell me the fish. Ah, slipping with the fishes.
However, I do have my concerns regarding the day. I'm hoping that Cynthia has not left her botanical gardens yet.
No, we're all still here waiting for the car to arrive. Come on through.
Ooh, we have quite a gathering, don't we? Hello, everyone. I'm Hamish, from the Highlands. Pleased to meet you. Cynthia, you're looking very bonny today, lassie.
You can cut the smooth talk, Hamish. It's a problem. I thought we were meeting you at the Botanical Gardens.
Aye, that was the original plan. But unfortunately, there has been a very slight hitch. Minuscule, actually. Nothing to worry about.
Hamish, you're beginning to worry me. It can't be that slight if it has sent you sashaying over here just before the cars arrive.
Well, now, how should I put this? Your vicar skedaddled. Would have said it. Now, here the piglets here left. No, piglets have left the pigsty.
Piglets have left the fucking pigsty.
That well-known phrase.
Oh, great.
Susan?
Oh, where's he gone? Oh, he can't just piss off with just minutes before he's needed, can he?
I'm afraid he can, and he appears he has. He left me with a phone message about an hour ago on my way home.
Oh, my phone.
On my home phone. My Brendan just called to tell me it seems to his head and his collar be turned.
Where's he gone in such short notice? If you know where he's gone, I'd chase him down and bring the bugger back. He can't have got far.
Apparently, he's eloped with someone called Murray, who used to starch with his dog collars for him.
Oh. An uncle on my mother's side of the family was called Murray. You could never trust him either. He always had his hands in places they had no business being.
This is Murray Me from Cleanse Away the Dry Cleaners, by any chance, is it?
I believe that is the young man in question. Do you know him?
He used to lend me his moisturiser for my hands after we finished a shift in the sponging department together. He was always very popular with the young girls. They called him Marry Me.
Aye, that would be him. Although, I think those lassies were probably backing up the wrong tree on that score. Though, he was very particular regarding the smoothness of his hands, was Murray. He really does treat his whole body as a temple.
That's very true. I was very envious of his luxurious skin.
Enough of this, Marie, and his smooth skin. What are we going to do? The bastard's run off with me vicar.
Oh, you lad, would you mind moving a little? You make a better door than a windy laddie. Oh, dear, I think I can see the wedding cars arriving.
Oh, my God. Stan and Robert will have left by now. What are we going to do? Hamish, what are you going to do? Apart from swinging around in your short kilt and looking out the windy. This is for you to sort out, Jimmy.
Wow. I know I've let you all in, but
something we can do. Think, everyone. There's got to be something.
Step in for the vicar, Stella. He's the only man without a defined role today.
And about that, this is big enough mess as it is. Let's not make it any worse by chucking petrol on the bonfire. I don't think which is the answer.
I could do it, Stella, though. I'm not stupid. Right. Dearly beloved, we gather today with the wedding presents to bear witness. Is it bear witness or just witness? I don't know. I can't remember. Is it?
No.
We gather here today to interrupt me if you want. To witness to the people. Cody.
William.
Richie, you might be onto something, Richie. Please, please play it out, mate. I mean, you were on a roll there, but you should know, Richie, you were Wolverine after all.
Wow. Oh, my God. Well, the pair of you should shut up. Let me think.
Those drivers are coming at your passing. Do you want me to go and fend them off until we can
get the plan? Don't say covering up my path. You might be out there fending off for quite a while. You might be out there fending off for quite a while, Betty. If the best we can come up with is Richie marrying me and Stan.
Maybe I could go and sweet talk them drivers. I've had to do a bit of sweet talking in my time. I remember the time Willie Russell, we had some laughs together, I can tell you. He wanted me for a role in Educating Rita, you know.
I thought that was Michael Caine.
Bloody hell, she's heard of someone.
Oh, Michael's right. But like a fool, again, I said no. Give it to Julie, I said. She could do with the work. Took me ages to sweet talk Willie into that. He really took some persuading. But I managed to talk him around in the end. But bloody Julie Walters, not a word of thanks from her.
I do know Michael Caine, but Willie and Julie, suppose these are people I should know too, but they're a mystery to me, Renee. Do you know them, William?
Willie Russell and Dame Julie Walters. You have never heard of them. They're only pillars of the stage and screen, Annabelle.
Is Michael Caine a pillar of stage and screen, Renee?
Oh, very much so, Annabelle, despite his slight vocal impediment.
What about Bradley Walsh? Stage and screen. My mum and dad went to see him at the Hippodrome last Christmas. He said he was very good.
No, Annabelle, playing Widow Twankey does not make you a pillar of the British stage and screen, no matter how much of your performance resembles one.
It must be very difficult for Widow Twankey, being reminded of her marital status every time someone addresses her, especially if the demise of her husband was a painful experience.
That is very, very true, Annabelle. How could you ever get over a tragedy like that if every time you went anywhere, everyone was, like, reminding you of your dead husband?
Mm-hmm.
Cody. That's two lines by me. What?
Tom.
What do you call it? What do you call a woman who's not married but whose partner doesn't die? No, when her partner does die?
Lucky. If the bloke is anything like you, Richie.
Oh, hello.
Well, this bloody widow is trying to change her status, and this discussion is not helping to resolve the situation.
Quite right, Mum. Go on then, Renee. See if you can hold him up for a few more moments to give us this some more thinking time.
Renee goes to try and stall the drivers. Suddenly, Stella jumps up.
I've got an idea. Give me a couple of minutes.
Stella rushes out the room.
Where's she off to? It'll be nice to have Vicar lurking in my downstairs bog.
After giving you a bit more thought, Gran, I don't think I'd be better off marrying you and Stan. I don't think I'm legally qualified. No, like, not being a captain of a ship or a pilot of a plane. Cody!
Or a member of the clergy.
What? What?
I don't know, I thought it was you.
No,
what is he on? What are you doing?
If we kept hanging around here for much longer, there might be time for you to do a Vicar's correspondence course, Richie.
Well, Renee's doing her best out there. She's really going to town on these three drivers. I hope those drivers are of legal age. They look very young to be getting tangled up with Renee.
Those drivers do look like they're getting quite overexcited, actually.
I have real concerns for those boys. I don't think they've advanced motor. I don't think they're advanced motorists. And they've got our wedding commitments this afternoon. I'm worried if they're going to be capable after experiencing that lassie's intentions.
Well, if you're so worried, Hamish, maybe you should go out and entertain them and leave us to figure out a way of shaking the monkey down from the greasy pail.
What was that? Pail.
I have no idea what that means, Betty.
Into the room.
Right, I've done the best I can. Let's get cracking.
Well, Stella, did you find a vicar lurking in Sin's downstairs bog after all?
Betty, why would there be a vicar in Gran's bog?
Sorry, Stella. Just a minute.
There's no time to waste, everyone. We're late enough as it is. Gran, Betty and William, get yourselves in the last car out there. We don't want Gran arriving first.
Hang on a bit. I need to visit that bog myself now.
Try not to be too long in there, Gran. Mum and you, Richie, go and get in the second car while we're waiting for Gran.
Stella Bab, I've never seen you in such control. I can see now why you and that William Stroker make such a strong team on your luxury coach trips. Come on then, Richie, move yourself, lad.
Has anybody seen my hard-boiled eggs?
Annabelle, Hamish and Renee. Where is Auntie Renee?
She's entertaining the troops while they wait. Oh my God, they're all in the same car together now. That front seat up is getting out of control. Let's hope no one starts a Mexican wave in it.
Well, I hope she leaves them drivers in the same condition she found them.
I think you might already be too late on that score, Hamish. And I don't advise you venture too far inside that car, not dressed in that kilt.
Cynthia comes back into the room.
Come on, Gran, what you been doing in there?
Pushed a little nugget out while I was in there. I'm ready now, though.
What have you come up with, Stella? How on earth have you managed to find another vicar at such short notice?
I'll tell you when I know it will definitely happen, Betty. But for now, its fingers and everything else for that matter are very tightly crossed. You and Gran better get going before Renee does some real damage to those drivers.
Okay, let's go, Simbam. But first, straighten up the back of your skirt. Looks as if you've been interfered with around the back.
There'll be no interfering going round the back or anywhere else until I'm respectfully married, Betty. Am I straight now, Bab?
You look grand, Hen. That Spudley's a lucky lad.
Okay then, come on, Hamish. Let's skedaddle, me lad, and get this bloody wedding party to the Botanical Gardens on time. And don't you dilly-dally on the way.
Woo!
Thank you.